Hello, everyone. I'm Arabdha. You're watching the Halborn AMA. And today we have got Mikhil Pandey, who is the team lead for pSTAKE by Persistence, joining us today. Welcome, Mikhil. And why don't you begin by telling us a little bit about yourself?
Hi, Arabdha. Thank you for having me. And thank you, the audience, for listening to this conversation. So like Arabdha said, I lead pSTAKE within Persistence. Persistence is a layer one tendermint-based chain, which is focused on liquid staked assets, and pSTAKE is solely focused on the issuance of those liquid staked assets, and getting users to use those liquid staked assets for multiple use cases. I have been with Persistence since the very beginning. I joined Persistence in 2019 when we are still figuring out what we are supposed to be building, and we've meandered through the space and reach this point where we are now focused only on liquid staking and applications around liquid staking. I started out as a market researcher and looked at a bunch of interesting things that were happening in the space. Very closely watched the entire DeFi summer 2020 unfold and had quite a great time, in fact. So during the DeFi summer, I realized that I have an interest in protocol design and understanding mechanisms in depth. Also, like everything around the token, how do you build utility to your token? Why is the token important for certain networks and certain protocols? And that kind of led me into diving deeper into building mechanisms. So for Persistence, as like I said, is on the blockchain level, is the layer one blockchain, on top of which we are building pSTAKE. pSTAKE is an application. So pSTAKE has its own token. Persistence has its own token. Persistence's native token is XPRT. You can compare it to Atom or any other Tendermint Cosmos-based asset. Because that's how Persistence is a Cosmos-based chain. So we are looking to launch the Persistence token XPRT in 2021. Well, we launched the token on 1st April 2021. So we're working on distributing the token widely before the launch, and kind of had this idea which a lot of people used to talk about even before we thought of it, which was stake drop, essentially distributing your token to people who stake certain assets instead of just randomly airdropping your tokens to a bunch of asset holders. So people had to stake their assets and let us know that they are staking their assets to receive the XPRT token. So designed the mechanism around that and realized that, there's a lot of retail demand and there's a lot of users who are looking to generate additional yield on top of the staked assets. Because when you stake your assets, you end up locking them. If you hold any POS assets like ETH, Atom, or a bunch of others. In fact, you just take them, you lock it up, you earn some yields, but that's not when you compare those yields to DeFi yields, it's barely anything, right? So users were looking to generate additional yield on top of that because the fact that you end up blocking liquidity, you can't do anything with your staked assets. We thought of building solutions around liquid staking, and that's kind of how we started building pSTAKE. So this was back in late 2020, somewhere around October, November, we figured out that this is a big problem in the space, which needs to be solved if we have to go beyond a certain point. So we decided to build liquid staking, and we started building pSTAKE with Atom, the liquid staking for Atom, but there were a lot of complications because Cosmos did not have IBC at the time, which is inter-blockchain communication. And it was really early days. POS was also very new for a lot of people. And beyond that, there was no DEX within the Cosmos ecosystem. So you couldn't really build liquid staking. And we can talk about how liquid staking works. But we sort of built a solution that a lot of people tried using. And we've kind of did a lot of experiment to understand what users really want. So we are now in a position where we can build solutions that people really want to use because we understand the space really well. And we have a lot of background in Cosmos and Tendermint-based chains, which is why we are going heavy on the Cosmos side, BNB side, because BNB, the Beacon chain itself, is a Tendermint-based chain, right? So given the expertise of the team, it just makes a lot of sense for us to spend time on building staking solutions for majorly chains like ecosystems like the BNB chain ecosystem and Cosmos.
Yeah, liquid staking does sound like a very interesting space, and looks like you guys have come a very far way along your journey there. Currently, I see that you're live on four chains. There's Cosmos, there's Ethereum, there's your own chain Persistence, and then there is the Binance BNB. What lies next? Any other chains that you're looking at right now?
So obviously beyond the chains that we already support, like I said, we have Atom and XPRT supported, but the asset, that the liquid staked asset, which we call STK assets, which represents staked asset, So right. STK Atom, STK XPRT were issued as ERC20 tokens because you could only liquefy those assets if there was a DEX, which we did not have in the Cosmos ecosystem. So right now we are working on a migration plan for users to move from STK Atom via ERC20 to STK Atom on the Persistence chain. But that is still being built out. What is being, we are going really heavy on the BNB chain ecosystem because we think, you know, there are, first of all, there are a lot of users in the Binance, in the BNB chain ecosystem, right? Because everything that happened in Q2 with the Terra collapse and all those things, people were looking for a new home and everybody started moving to an ecosystem that made a lot of sense for them. So we do see a lot of people moving to the BNB chain ecosystem, and they were like, you know, while everything was down, I think there were more than like new addresses were being created on the BNB chain every single day. And that was still up as per the Messari, you know, report recently that was pushed out for Q2. So yeah, I think, you know, our goal as of now is to push really hard and you know, go heavy on integrations within the BNB chain ecosystem because we recently launched STK BNB. But beyond that, we'll also be looking to expand to other assets like Sol, AVAX, and a few others, which you know, we'll talk about once we have something concrete there.
All right, that sounds super, super interesting. We have talked a lot about different aspects and we have been mentioning liquid staking a lot. So do you want to tell us very simply, what is BNB liquid staking all about?
Yeah, so, you know, like I can maybe talk about this with an example. So if you hold BNB, right, and you want to stake it. Now, when you stake your BNB, you secure the chain because you're staking your assets with a validator or delegating your assets to a validator who's producing blocks. And right. The more stake there is on a network, the better the security of the network, because there's essentially you want as many people to stake as much of the assets as possible to have a very high security of the network. But as of today, there's not a lot of assets staked on the BNB beacon chain, which is what we are looking to solve. The reason behind that is, if you, let's say, hold 100 BNB, right, you would stake that. If you stake that 100 BNB natively on the chain, what ends up happening is, okay, you'll earn some staking rewards, which is about 5.5% as of now. But you end up locking your assets. You can't do anything with it. That's it. They are locked up sitting there. And when you need to use those assets to do something else, or to withdraw it, you can't do it instantly. You'll have to wait for something that is called an unbonding period or cool off period, which is usually 7 days, 7 days for BNB chain. And, it could range from 7 to 28 days for other networks. So it's not the best user experience, which is why not a lot of people stake their assets and not a lot of people are looking to stake their assets, but it is very, very important for the security of the network. And, which is why we are building liquid staking, because with liquid staking, you don't have to choose between staking your assets or using them in DeFi. You can do both at the same time. How? Because the moment, so pSTAKE as a protocol, you can go to bnb.pstake.finance. You can, as long as you have BNB, you can click on deposit and stake. As soon as you stake, pSTAKE will stake your assets with a set of validators in the background and will issue you a representative token, which we call staked BNB or STK BNB. This STK BNB, as long as you have that STK BNB, you can use it, to redeem back the BNB. But you can also use this STK BNB token in DeFi and like use it to provide liquidity, to use it. You can use it as collateral to borrow another asset against it. You can do a bunch of exciting things. Basically, you can do everything that you can do with your BNB, but at the same time, you're securing the network. You are also earning staking rewards and you're earning DeFi yields. So that's how liquid staking works and STK BNB works.
Right, that definitely clarifies a lot, and I can see how it differs from general staking strategies as well. We're talking about Halborn and our work with you guys. So I have to ask you, what is your thought process around security and how do you go about getting your best auditing partner on board?
Yeah, absolutely. So at pSTAKE, we've worked with a lot of security auditors and for our other products, which are like STK Atom, STK XPRT, we've gone through the entire process of working with a bunch of auditors. And now we are working with Halborn and folks like Certora, and we've like had a lot of experience working with different auditors. What we do realize is that it is very, very important to have that communication between the two teams, where the auditors are constantly asking you questions about what's this, what's that, and they are actually like looking to dig deeper into the actual issues or the solution itself that you've built out to understand, first you need to understand what the solution is to figure out what the problem could be. Halborn, we really like the part where, you know, it's always very, very constructive and there's always some communication happening. And that's kind of, you know, the reason why we work with Halborn as a long-term partner, because this is not just a one-off project that Halborn is auditing with pSTAKE. Halborn will also be auditing other pSTAKE solutions that we are building. You know, the new SDK Atom implementation will also be audited by Halborn. Other products within the Persistence ecosystem which are built by third-party developers on Persistence are also going to be audited by Halborn. So we really like working with Halborn and kind of, you know, want to make sure that security is of the highest priority, because every product that we've launched, we first had a few audits before we've launched those products. For users to sleep peacefully after deploying their assets on a protocol, I think they need to have some sense of security that the protocol has been audited. And, you know, it's for us as well, right? Because we want to be sure that we are putting out, you know, products that are actually secure before, you know, like just pushing them out. Yeah. So that's the security approach. For STKBNB, we've already been audited by other auditors as well. So TechShield and Certora have also, you know, we've also worked with those two audit firms. Certora is a little different in the sense that they are a formal, you know, that's a formal verification, which is a little different to traditional auditing. But Halborn, we've really enjoyed working with and we'll hopefully continue working with them for the longest time.
Glad to hear that. And also very happy to hear that security is such a priority with you guys. Mikhil, if I take a few steps back, I see that you started with marketing research and then you ended up doing what you're doing right now. So tell me a little bit about your journey as well.
Yeah, so I graduated in 2019 as an engineer from the University of Mumbai. And obviously I did not want to do a traditional job. I was never into it. And I did not want to be like a developer, because I thought that I had much better skills, on the other side of the fence, where I could, you know, understand things and explain them to the audience better. And I always wanted to be, you know, part of a startup. So I started looking into the different things that could be done. So in 2019, I was looking into crypto and I was really excited by it, mostly Ethereum. I think I was sold on Ethereum and not anything else, to be honest. I'm glad I've seen all the other ecosystems, but I think Ethereum has been one of the most exciting ecosystems I've ever, you know, jumped into. So I looked at that and I was like, okay, this is interesting. And then I started looking for opportunities. That's how I met Tushar, who's the founder and CEO of Persistence. And I spoke to him and, you know, I liked his vision. Persistence was trying to do something really different at the time than most, you know, crypto projects, because it was very, you know, crypto in general in 2019 was like everybody was trying to somewhat do the same thing, which is still the case, but, you know, it's hard to tell when you're an outsider. So I started working at Persistence as a market researcher and started digging into, you know, what used to happen on the research in the market, mostly from a marketing perspective. But I never could really like grasp anything. I was like not interested. I felt like, okay, I'm more interested in learning some of the other things. So if I was looking at like Compound or synthetics, I would much rather spend time on understanding some of the mechanisms. And that kind of made me understand that, okay, this is what I really want to do. So I started like using every protocol that I could. You know, I remember using like 10 products a day at the time and understanding, reading through the docs, trying to understand as much of the code as I could. And that's kind of how I realized that, okay, this is what where my interest lie in designing mechanism, understanding mechanisms and building stuff. So I sort of looked at StakeDrop and had this idea that, okay, you know, this can be, it wasn't even called StakeDrop back then, I think, but I looked at it and I thought that, okay, this could be an interesting way of distributing tokens. Nobody was implementing it. The idea was there for a while. So I just decided that, okay, this is something I want to take up. So, you know, I decided to take that initiative and started working on that. And then obviously the natural progression was liquid staking. And I thought this is something great. You know, this is what I want to build as well. And because I looked at staking, then, you know, the issues with staking, understood the mechanism behind staking, understood the issues with staking, then, you know, wanted to solve a problem for staking. And that's how I started working on liquid staking. Made a bunch of mistakes. You know, I will not deny that we've learned quite a bit with everything that we've tried. You know, especially with SDK Atom, XPRT, we tried a bunch of things. Like we went ahead and did something that nobody else was doing, a dual token model and all those things, which might have worked out on any other network, but not on Ethereum due to the nature of Ethereum, because it's a very expensive chain to use. But yeah, so, you know, from all these learnings, we've come to this point where I know what I really want to do, and that is to build products and think of ideas to take those products to market, and, you know, yeah, just get to the top. So that's what I've been doing, and that's kind of what my journey has been like.
Well, thank you for sharing that. I'm always amazed by all these DeFi career transitions and all the trials and tribulations that come with that, right? Well, thank you again for joining us on this AMA. Maybe I'll ask you one final question before we call this a wrap, which is, if you were to talk to other builders in this space, what would one piece of advice be that you'd give them?
The best advice that I have received, and I never believed in it, I have always been very conservative in my approach to building stuff. I was always like, okay, this has to be perfect, then we go out with it. I think the faster you go out, the earlier you realize that, okay, you know, this is how it should actually be. And I would only like suggest people to take that approach and, like, yeah, just keep that momentum up, keep pushing stuff out and learning from them instead of trying to build something perfect, because the iterative approach is the best approach that anyone can ever take, because you'll never get to the perfect solution. You'll always aim to get there, and that is what the goal should be.
Right, so fast MVPs and sprint trials. That's actually the second time we are talking about this today. So very interesting advice. Thank you again for talking to us, and let's stay connected. Thank you.